It's a pleasure for me to introduce our first plenary speaker who will try to tame uncertainty. Roberto Tempo is very well known to us, but I will give you some short information about him. Roberto is director of research of the GNR Institute, Instituto di Elettronica di Ingegneria dell'Informazione e delle Telecomunicazioni of the Politecnico di Torino. Roberto was born in Italy in Cuone, 1980. He graduated in electrical engineering at the Politecnico di Milano, and 1983 he received his PhD. After a period spent in Torino, he joined the GNR, and now he is Director of Research of System and Computer Engineering. But he was not always in Italy. He had several research positions in China, in Japan, in US, but also in Germany, for example, in Oberpfaffenhofen at the German Aerospace Research Organization. He has a very broad activity and rich research. I only want to mention analysis and design of complex network systems. And of course, uncertainty plays a major role, and you can imagine how complicated is the page rank computation for Google, or localization of wireless sensor networks. And on all his topics, he published more than 180 research papers, and he is co-author of a new book about randomized algorithms for analysis and control of uncertain systems. Take a look at Springer. You will find some information there. I will only shortly mention some of his contributions and awards. He was president of the IEEE Control Society. He accepted, and I'm very happy, as the secretary of Ifac, the invitation to serve as the editor-in-chief of Automatica. He has been editor for technical notes and correspondence of IEEE transactions on automatic control. He is member of several advisory boards. Many of us will know him as a co-chair from the IEEE conference on decision and control now 2 years ago in Florence, Italy. But he was also program chair on the first IEEE conference on decision and control, which took part together with the European Control System Conference in Seville. So, because of time, I will skip something. He is fellow of Ifac. He got the Distinguished Member Award of IEEE. He is fellow of IEEE, and he got also Outstanding Prize Paper Awards. Roberto, I stop now, and I will leave the floor to you. Please let us give him an applause.
Test. Yes, it works. So thank you very much for the very kind introduction. It's a pleasure for being here. Also, I would like to warmly thank the General Chair, Luigi De Re, for the invitation and the trust, and everybody else who, in the shadow, contributed to the organization of this wonderful event. I'm sure it will be a great successful conference. So as the title of my talk suggests, today we are going to discuss how randomization can help in dealing with uncertainty in control systems. So here is a short overview of my talks, the main points. So we start with some motivations. So I will start with a simple, very simple, innocent example dealing with stochastic model predictive control, just to get you hungry and hopefully excited about this research topic. I will then move on a little bit to a more serious application dealing with UAV and to discuss how uncertainty can enter into the picture. Then I will move on to more formal description of uncertain systems, and particularly on deterministic and probabilistic methods. And then we'll discuss, we'll introduce some formal definitions, mainly borrowed from computer science regarding randomized algorithms, and then study sampling-based methods for convex optimization. And I will briefly mention that convex optimization is not the end of the story. We can do more. And beyond convexity, statistical learning theory. And then towards conclusion, I will mention just a few points on some happenings at the frontier, just to give you some highlights of some research directions that, in my opinion, are interesting. So stochastic model predictive control. So the point is that here it's a very simple example of a linear system with no linear uncertainty. It's an innocent example. We have two states. We have one input, so we have two states, x1, x2, and then we have one input u, and then we have a few uncertain parameters. In this specific example, we have q1, q2, q3, which denote the uncertain parameter. This example is discrete time, and also the uncertainty is time varying, just to make things a little more complicated, but it's not really important because most of the talk will be focused on time invariant uncertainty. Then we have deterministic or probabilistic uncertainty. This is a sort of a dichotomy. When we want to represent uncertainty, we have two different ways to represent uncertainty. So in this case, we have a linear system with no linear uncertainty. I'm using throughout the talk Q to denote the vector of uncertainty. So we have a discrete time system, x of k plus 1 equal to a of q x of k plus b of q u of k. Then we have this deterministic uncertainty, q1, q2, q3. It means that each entry of this vector, so q1, is bounded, for example, in this interval, minus 0.1.1, and so q2 and q3 are bounded in another interval. The counterpart is probabilistic uncertainty. So in this case, we assume that q is a random variable, and q is distributed according to some PDF, for example, uniform. And in this special example, we have that q1 is uniformly distributed in the same interval as before, minus 0.1.1. So there are two different ways to represent uncertainty, and both are equally valid, depending on the specific application. Well, then, of course, we are interested in system constraints. And so, again, we may have two different representations of system constraints. One is deterministic, hard constraints, and the other is probabilistic, which are soft constraints. So, for example, we can imagine that there is a saturation into the input. So we have input saturation. It means that the input u of k is upper bounded by a value which is, for example, 0.5. And then we have probabilistic soft constraints on the state. So the state x1 in absolute value is bounded by 2, and the x2 state is bounded by 3. And then we have the probability. Probability k is conditional probability given the state xk. So this is probability at step k plus 1. So in this case, we say that the probability is greater or equal than 1 minus epsilon, and you can imagine that epsilon is a small number, so it means high probability. So this is a different description on the constraints, and it is clearly soft. Well, in the stochastic model predictive control, as many of you know, we are interested in determining receding horizon control to compute an input sequence u of k. So what we want to do is to minimize conditional expectation, which is denoted with the symbol ek, of finite horizon quadratic cost. So we have a quadratic cost, which is X transpose SX. S is a positive definite matrix, 2 by 2, because we have two states. In this case, we take it diagonal, 1 and 0 in the diagonals, plus U transpose RU. We have only one input. So this is R is a scalar, and you know, we take it equal to 1. And then we have a terminal cost, X transpose K plus H, P, X OK plus H, and P is a non-negative definite matrix, which is, represents the terminal cost, which is generally computed offline solving a Riccati equation. And then we want to minimize, with respect to U of K, the sum between K and K plus H, which is the finite horizon of this expected value. So here I have a picture which somewhat illustrates what is the objective of stochastic model predictive control. So we want to compute an input sequence, U of K, which represents the future, in order to predict the states within soft bounds. So it means that we want to solve this optimization problem in order to compute the prediction of the state and also to compute soft bounds around that. And in this picture, we have shown, for example, Gaussian density, just to show you that these are soft bounds. So there is a nominal value, and then there is some uncertainty in the prediction of the state. And then in this case, we have the constraints. So we have probabilistic constraints on the state and the uncertainty. And since we really want to deal with saturation in the input, in this case, we have deterministic constraints on the input. So this is the objective of stochastic model predictive control. What is the counterpart? The counterpart is robust model predictive control. In this case, we substitute the expectation with the maximum with respect to Q. So again, we want to compute an input sequence, U of K, such that it solves this quadratic cost for the worst possible Q in some bounding set. And in this case, the objective is to compute the predictive state within hard bounds. And in this picture, you can see that there is a nominal value, which is the center of the interval. And then we have an interval, which represents a hard bound. So it's a plus or minus value. And this is guaranteed. So this is a key difference between the previous one and this one. And in this case, what are the constraints? Well, we have the state system in discrete time. And in this case, we have deterministic constraints on input state uncertainty. So there are two different counterparts, and here this picture shows the feasibility region. What is the feasibility region? Well, it's the set of states where the model predictive control optimization problem, either subject to deterministic or probabilistic constraint, is feasible. And here you can see that we have two different areas. The red area, which is the robust one, so which is computed usually using the standard methods for robust model predictive control, so solving a min-max problem. The other area is the green area, which is the feasible region of stochastic model predictive control. So this example shows that the green area is larger than the other one, so this is an advantage. What is the disadvantage? The disadvantage is that the states in the green area are only guaranteed with some probability. So there is a loss which is expressed in probability. So I guess that this example, the main point of this example, is to motivate you on the tools that I'm going to explain during the talk in order how to construct the green region. This example is joint work by Matthias Lorenzen, Frank Elgauer, Fabrizio Dabene, and myself. It's a very recent work that we started doing on this topic. So this is a simple example trying to explain the differences between deterministic and probabilistic uncertainty. And now I want to spend a few minutes discussing a more serious application that I've been involved, and this is my joint work with Elisa Capello. So this deals with UAV. So when you are working on UAV design, one of the issues is that you have many physical uncertain parameters, and also you have uncertainty, which is non-physical, which enters in the aerodynamic database. So you represent the system in continuous time in this case, like x dot equal to a of qx plus b of qu. So the uncertainty q enters in both a and b matrices. We assume, in fact, that this is what happens. We have enough sensors on board, so the state is completely measurable, so there is no need for an output equation. The point is that the uncertainty enters in a very ugly fashion into the nonlinear system, into the linear system. And this is why we are interested in nonlinear uncertainty also for linear systems. This work has been performed in the context of a project, of a big project called Ifac, Information Technology for Humanitarian Assistance, Cooperation and Action. In particular, we have been involved in a work package for archaeological site monitoring. And in the bottom picture, you can see the UAV that we have built during the landing phase. And in the above picture, you can see here within this yellow circle, the shadow of the UAV flying above a Roman temple in northern, in an area called which was called at the time of the Roman Empire Augusta Bagenorum in northern Italy. And so the UAV is taking picture of the Roman temple as also of itself. So this is one of the work packages that we've been involved. So archaeological site monitoring, because some of the archaeological sites are not easily accessible. So what is the point that I want to make here? Well, we have lots of uncertain parameters which are entering into this UAV. And so there are variations of flight conditions. And these variations of flight conditions give rise to turbulence. And of course, turbulence is very undesirable, because if the UAV moves around, then clearly you have problems because the pictures are not high quality. So you have physical parameters, moment of inertia, load, speed, and so on. For example, the load may change depending if you have one camera on board, which is a visual camera, or two cameras on board, which could be visual and infrared camera. And in this case, you have a nominal value, for example, of the load, which is 620 grams, and then there is a plus or minus 10% range. And you want, in this case, we take uniform density function because we want to guarantee the same performance for all values within this interval. On the other hand, there are also variations of geometric parameters. And this is from a manufacturing process. This leads to the aerodynamic data. In this case, we can estimate very well the standard deviation of these parameters as well as the nominal value. So we use a Gaussian density function. The point is that these uncertain parameters are entered in a very ugly fashion, using trigonometric functions or polynomial functions and so on, in the entry A11 of the matrix. So they are very highly nonlinear uncertainty entering into the parameters. So this is why we are interested in probabilistic uncertainty, because the classical robust method do not work really well when you have nonlinear uncertainty. So this is to motivate the fact that we are interested in this talk to develop tools for dealing with nonlinear uncertainty entering into linear systems. So now we are going to discuss uncertain systems, deterministic and probabilistic methods. Well, you know, here it's a way to represent deterministic uncertainty. So deterministic uncertainty is the pessimistic viewpoint. And here there is a sentence by Yogi Berra, which says that if there is a 50-50 chance that something can go wrong, 9 out of 10 times it will. So this is the, you know, really pessimistic viewpoint. And here is a picture of Yogi Berra during one of his famous baseball catches. And a very successful area of research within our community where the pessimistic viewpoint has been used is the case when you are dealing with stability with parametric uncertainty. The counterpart is probabilistic uncertainty, which is the optimistic viewpoint. And here there is another sentence, in this case by Anonymous, which says, "Don't assume the worst case scenario. It's emotionally draining and probably won't happen anyway." And an example, a very successful example, of the optimistic viewpoint is LQG. Okay, so what is now, I mean, the next step is, which is not taken in LQG, is to introduce the concept of random uncertainty, which plays a major role in the last part of my talk. So now we introduce random uncertainty. So we have a vector, Q, the notation at this point is fixed, minimal notation, Q, which is, it could be a vector or a matrix, doesn't really matter. And Q is bounded in some support set, capital Q, which is a subset of Rm. So we have lots of parameters, lots of uncertain parameters. N can be very large. And then we assume that there is a multivariate uniform density function associated to Q and Q. And for example, uniform. Most of the talk I'm thinking about uniform, but the theory is general. It's actually distribution free. And here is just a formal definition of a multivariate uniform density function. So U of Q is equal to 1 over the measure of Q. If Q is in Q, 0 otherwise. And here is a simple picture showing that uniform PDF in a circle. Okay. At this point, I have defined what is random uncertainty. Now it's, I want to formally define what is what are the system constraints. So system constraints, I use the symbol F. It's a mapping between Q, our bounding set Q, into R. And here, just a little point which is very important. The only assumption that I'm making in this talk about the dependence on F and Q is that F is a measurable function. So you can, basically, it's very general. You can deal with nonlinear uncertainty. You can deal with any uncertainty, basically, that you like. So an example is H infinity. So you have a transfer function in this case, disturbances and errors. And they assume that G of SQ is stable. And then you set this constraint F of Q equal to the H infinity norm of G of SQ. And then there is a threshold gamma. And then I'm asking if this F of Q is greater than gamma or not. Well, we can plot the body plot, the absolute value. But of course, you know, we have uncertainty. So we have a family of body plots. So we talk about the envelope of the body plots. And here you can see that a bunch of systems are above this value. So in this case, I mean, we don't satisfy this constraint. So we have a violation. And so it's very natural at this point to introduce a measure of violation. And the measure of violation is defined in terms of probability. So we define, given lambda gamma, we define the probability of violation. And we indicate the probability of violation V, it's a violation with respect to the function, to the constraint F. And this is simply the measure of elements in the Q set such that this is violated. So as you can see here, there is a bunch of systems which are above the gamma level. And so how many within the Q set are violating? Well, this is the probability of violation. Now, if you increase the value gamma to this value here, above that, you see that there is no violation. In that case, the violation probability is equal to zero. So why we are interested in defining violation? Well, we are interested in defining sufficiently small violation within epsilon. So we are saying that the viewpoint that we are taking now is that if the violation is less or equal than epsilon, where epsilon is a small probabilistic value, then we are happy because epsilon is in the interval 0, 1, in the open interval. So, but we are happy because there is a small violation. Equivalently, you can talk about the reliability. 1 minus the violation is the reliability, so you don't have a violation. So instead of looking at this greater than gamma, you're looking at less or equal than gamma, and in this case, you have that the reliability, it indicates how reliably the system is greater than 1 minus epsilon. Okay, so far, so good. We have introduced the concept of violation, the concept of reliability, and so on. The question, however, is computationally. Computationally, computing the violation probability, or the reliability, if you wish, is very hard. Why it's very hard? Well, just for simplicity, let's take uniform PDF into Q. And then you see immediately that this violation, or reliability in this case, it's a so-called vol over vol problem. So you have a normalization, so you have to divide this by the volume of the Q set. And then, which is, so if the Q set is somewhat, you know, simple enough, an hypercube or a sphere or whatever, you can easily compute the volume of Q, so you know what is the denominator. What is hard to compute is the numerator. You have a measure here, but in particular, the domain of integration is given by this F of Q less or equal than gamma, which is the constraint that we have. So basically, this problem is an ugly problem in numerical analysis, which requires computing volumes of sets with non-convex domains in high-dimensional spaces. So this is extremely hard to compute. And so for M small, say, you know, a couple of parameters, a couple of uncertain parameters, this is a very special constraint F, then this computation is easy because maybe you have a two-dimensional integral to solve or so, but in general, this is very hard. So in general, this is very hard integration problem over non-convex domains. And paraphrasing Richard Bellman, I can say that here what enters into the picture is the curse of dimensionality. So the computation of this integral becomes extremely difficult when M is large. And this is why we need to introduce a tool, which is a technical tool, of randomized algorithms for computing approximation of the violation. So that's the point. So here is the formal definition of a randomized algorithm, which is borrowed from computer science. So from computer science, a randomized algorithm is an algorithm that makes random choices during execution to produce a result. And the simplest random choice that I can think about is just a coin toss. So you toss a coin, and then if you get head or tail, then with equal probability, assuming that you have a perfect coin, then you basically take different steps inside the randomized algorithm. There is a very special class of randomized algorithm, which is called Monte Carlo randomized algorithm, which is well known to everyone. A Monte Carlo randomized algorithm is a randomized algorithm that provides approximate results. So the results are no longer exact, so approximate results. However, with bounded probability of failure, and here I indicated probability of failure in quotation mark because I have to define it formally, and I'm going to do that in a few minutes. So when we are in the world of Monte Carlo randomized algorithm, we accept the fact that we may fail to compute the exact result. So we only compute approximate result. And the probability of failure, so that's the bad news. So we don't compute the exact results. The good news is that the probability of failure can be made arbitrarily small. So the probability of making mistake is very small. And then we will see this formally in a few minutes. Well, just from the point of view of Monte Carlo history, Monte Carlo was invented in the 40s by several famous people, Metropolis, Ulam, von Neumann, and so forth. In the 40s, during the Manhattan Project for the nuclear bomb, and people, of course, these people were working on physics, and so they were dealing with particles and lots of experiments, huge size experiments, and they needed to estimate how good or how bad their experiments, so they came out with this beautiful idea of Monte Carlo. So here I want to just to formally define a Monte Carlo experiment. Monte Carlo experiment is in order to compute the violation probability. So in order to compute the violation probability, I perform capital N Monte Carlo simulations. So it means that I have to draw N IID identically independent and identically distributed random samples of Q. I'm saying samples, but Q is in general a vector, so random vectors, according to a given probability measure, for example, uniform. And so just from the notation viewpoint, I have Q1, Q2, Qn, which represents each Qi is a vector in the bounding set Q. And so here, for example, I'm taking Q as a circle, and I have n IID sample within the circle. From the notation viewpoint, I can introduce the notation which is, say, the multi-sample, which is using this symbol here, which is just stacking together all the sample Q1, Q2, Qn. Well, I can now compute an approximation of the violation. This approximation of the violation is called the empirical violation. How it is constructed? Very simple. Let k the number of samples such that f of qi is less or equal than gamma. So this is the number of successes. Every time I generate a sample, then I check if the constraint for the specific sample qi is less or equal than gamma. Okay? And then I count how many successes I have and say that k is the number of successes. Well, the total number of successes divided by the total number of experiments is the empirical violation, which is denoted with the symbol V and hat. Well, more formally, I can introduce an indicator function. This indicator function is a binary function which takes values either 0 or 1. And in case of a success for the sample I set the indicator function equal to 1. In case of a failure, I set the indicator function equal to 0. And then formally, I can define the empirical violation as simply I'm taking the sum for all these indicator functions, and I divide by n. Well, just to make sure that this concept is well defined, suppose that I always get the indicator function equal to 0. So I sum 0, 0, 0 n times, I get 0. So 0 divided by n is still 0. It means that the lower bound of this violation is 0, which makes sense. What is the upper bound? Well, suppose that I always have the indicator function equal to 1. I sum 1, 1, 1 n times, I get n. I divide by n, I get 1. So it means that the violation, the empirical violation, is in the interval 0, 1. So it's a well-defined probability. One important point from the computational point of view is the following. There is really no need to compute f of qi. It suffices to check if f of qi is less or equal than gamma. So it suffices to check if this inequality is satisfied. Why this is important? Well, suppose that you are interested in Lyapunov problem and you want to perform this Monte Carlo experiment for a Lyapunov problem, then you have to check positive definiteness of an n by n symmetric matrix. And this requires n cube of floating point operations. So the point here is that there is no need to compute directly eigenvalues. So we don't need to compute eigenvalues. We just need to compute if f of qi is less or equal than 0. So it means that it suffices to check, say, if, for example, some of the roots of a polynomial are in the left up plane or not. There is no need to formally compute eigenvalues. So this is important from the computation viewpoint. Well, now I'm introducing the concept of sample complexity, which I think is a crucial concept. So given probabilistic parameters, epsilon and delta, in the open interval 0, 1, called accuracy and confidence. Now, what is the sample complexity? Well, given accuracy epsilon, we need to compute the sample complexity, which is the smallest integer n, such that this probability inequality is satisfied. So let me explain. Well, we have the true probability, which is the true violation v. I have the empirical evaluation vn. Well, I want to have the difference between the true probability, the true violation, and the empirical violation small, so within epsilon. However, the empirical violation is based on randomization. So this is a random variable. So the result is that this quantity is an event. So this quantity is itself characterized by a probability. I want to have this event likely to happen, so I want to have the probability of this event large, greater or equal than 1 minus delta. So what is the story here? The story is that we have two probability levels. We have a probability of probability, because this is a probability itself, but then we have another probability here. And this is maybe sometimes it creates confusion, but this is how it is. I mean, without the outer probability, this does not make any sense, because this is an event. So there are two probability levels. So what we are interested in here, we are interested in computing the smallest value of n such that this probability inequality is satisfied. And here leads to the concept of two-sided Hoeffian inequality. Two-sided Hoeffian inequality, well, let's say that a Monte Carlo randomized algorithm may fail, as we discussed a few minutes ago. And here I can just define what is the probability of failure, which is what I introduced a minute ago. So the only difference is now I'm a little more formal. I introduce here the multi-sample, saying that the underlying probability here is in the multi-sample space. So given accuracy epsilon, the two-sided Hoeffian inequality states that this quantity, which is the probability of failure, is less or equal than this quantity here. E is the Euler number, so it's an exponential. Okay? And this Hoeffian inequality tells us something very important. As we say that we can fail. However, the probability of failure is bounded because this quantity is bounded. And also, it vanishes exponentially because if I take epsilon small, changing epsilon, this decreases exponentially. Also, it can be made arbitrarily small, taking n sufficiently large. So if I perform more and more experiments, this bound on the probability of failure becomes smaller and smaller. So the point is that, okay, so now I want to compute the sample complexity. So what is n? Well, it's the intermediate step between the Hoeffian inequality and the Chernoff bound. Well, the Hoeffian inequality, now suppose that I introduce the confidence. So I want to have an upper bound on this quantity here. And this quantity here on the right-hand side of this probability inequality is less or equal than delta. Okay? I want to bound the probability of failure by delta. Well, then computing n in using a numerical computation of n is straightforward. I can simply write a MATLAB code, and then I start, n is an integer, so I start with n equal to 1. I check if it is satisfied. If not, I increase n, and then I can even do bisection if I want to do something more sophisticated, and then at some point I will succeed, and then I stop. But in fact, we can do something more than this, and this is the Chernoff bound. So what is the Chernoff bound? Well, it's what we call inverting the bound. Inverting the bound is that given epsilon and delta, I want to compute n directly so that this inequality is satisfied. Well, it's a straightforward. I mean, you just divide the two sides of this inequality by 2, you take the log, and then this is what you get. So the Chernoff bound is log of 2 over delta divided by 2 epsilon squared. Okay? Before I go on, what is the take-home message for students here? Students were mentioned before during the opening ceremony. The take-home message for students is this. Whatever is the problem that you are working with, The question is that, think about how many simulations you need to perform in order to get a certain accuracy and confidence. So keep in mind the Chernow bound, because it's a useful indication of the number of simulations you have to perform in order to get something which is reliable. Very often I talk to students and they tell me that they have done 1,000 experiments. I say, why? Well, I don't know. And so, I mean, I think it's an important concept for students. Well, sample complexity revisited. So the Chernow bound provides a fundamental explicit relation, which is the sample complexity, which tells us how delta and epsilon enter into the picture. As you can see, epsilon enters in a quadratic fashion, and delta enters in a logarithmic fashion. Confidence is very cheap because it enters in logarithmic fashion. Accuracy is more expensive, and here it's a simple table showing that for some values of epsilon and delta, for example, the Chernow bounding is in the order of millions, not too bad, given the computing power that we have today. One important point is that the sample complexity can be computed a priori before performing the experiment. So this is something which I think is important. Going back to the title of the talk, taming uncertainty. Why we are taming uncertainty? No course of dimensionality. The sample complexity does not depend on the number of uncertain parameters. It does not depend on the shape of Q. It does not depend on the underlying probability density function. So whatever underlying probability density function you have, whatever shape of Q you have, I mean, you still have the same Chernow bound. Of course, there is a little catch. The catch is that assuming that a polynomial time oracle to draw n IID samples in Q exists, and this is not always straightforward. For example, suppose that you're interested in sampling the Schur region for checking, say, Schur stability of a linear system. Well, of course, you know, this Schur region can be complicated, and so in this case, we have algorithms which are polynomial time for sampling uniformly the Schur region, but it takes some work. Other cases when we are interested in drawing samples, IID, within, for example, the spectral norm ball. It takes a lot of work to do that, but it can be shown that so polynomial time algorithms exist in many, many, many instances. Well, here I just want to quickly, the important point is that the sample Q1, Q2, Qn are IID, and this leads immediately to parallel and distributed simulations. So in principle, you can have n machines work in parallel, each machine work with a sample, and then, you know, everything together, at the end of the day, we have one machine which put everything together. And this theory is related to the theory, and this is not the case for Markov chain Monte Carlo, because these methods are sequential. So Markov chain Monte Carlo is not cannot be applied here. Well, this theory is more general, the theory of random matrices, but this is for another talk. So I want to move on and discuss how these methods could be useful for convex optimization. Well, now I mean, so this is consists of three parts. The first part is the so-called scenario approach. Well, here is the robust viewpoint. So we're interested in a semi-infinite optimization problem. So now we complicate the problem. Now we have design variables, optimization variables, whatever you want to call. So the constraints F depends on Q, but it also depends on some theta parameters that you want to design. And okay, so we assume that for fixed Q, this function F is convex in theta. Okay, so we have a convexity in how these design parameters enter into the picture. Now, from the point of view of the uncertainty, still measurability suffices. So given theta, the constraint is a measurable function. Okay, so we have a semi-infinite optimization problem. It means that we minimize an objective function which is linear, C transpose X, subject to an infinite number of constraints. So this is the robust viewpoint. So for all, so we have a number of constraints for all Q into Q. And there is a very nice idea which came out a few years ago by Calafiore and Campi, which is the idea that they call it scenario approach. It's a very nice idea. So consider now random uncertainty Q, and then you simply take random samples of Q. So draw n IID random sample Qi, construct the sample constraints. So you have f of theta Q1, f of theta Q2, and so on and so forth. And then you form a so-called scenario problem. You have a scenario optimization problem, which is like before. But now, instead of an infinite number of constraints, you have a finite number of constraints. The solution to this optimization problem is called the theta scenario. The question is that how much are losing? How much we violate? How far is this theta scenario from the true theta scenario? And then there is a subsequent result by Marco Campi and Garatti, which is also a beautiful result. And Marco Campi and Garatti, basically, they told us that suppose that n, epsilon, and delta are given, and they satisfy this binomial inequality, where n is the number of design parameters. Okay? Then we probability at least 1 minus delta, it holds that the violation for the scenario solution is less or equal than epsilon. So it means that the violation associated to the scenario solution is small, is within epsilon, and this event holds with probability at least 1 minus delta, with high probability. There are some minor technical feasibility and uniqueness assumptions which are needed, but for the time being, I'm going to skip them since this is a general talk. The question is that how can invert the bound now? How can invert this binomial bound? You remember that from the Hövding inequality to the Chernow bound, it was a straightforward step. Here it is not the case. Inverting the bound, I mean, given epsilon and delta, I want to compute the smallest n which satisfies this quantity is not easy. And in fact, so computing the sample complexity is not easy. Well, we can resort to numerical methods and somewhat use one of the standard tables that are available, for example, in books on statistics. So these are charts which are generated by numerical. So this is done numerically. So these charts are parameterized, for example, for a fixed value of delta. There are several curves. Each curve is for a different n. And here you can see the confidence intervals related to the probability. So the point is that this is a more general problem than the scenario problem. It's a problem that arises when you're interested in computing the confidence intervals. What is the sample complexity for the confidence intervals? Given epsilon and delta, how you compute n? Well, you can use these methods numerically, but in fact, you can do better than that. And here it's a nice bound, which is joint work with Teodoro Alamo and other people from Seville. He came out in Automatica recently. So this is the sample complexity of, we call it n bin for the binomial. This is the sample complexity. What is the advantage of this bound compared to previous bounds? Well, in fact, we can squeeze the constant. So in previous bounds, there was a constant of 2, and this constant of 2 is now squeezed to this value, which is e divided by e minus 1, which is 1.5820. It took a long time, a lot of work to squeeze this bound. But in fact, it is meaningful, I think, because suppose that epsilon is now equal to 10 to the minus 6. Well, I mean, if you use the bound 2, it means that you have to draw 2 million samples. With this new bound, you have only to draw 1.58 million samples. So from the computational point of view, there is a nice advantage. Well, this bound, which is already known, so it tells us that epsilon enters in a nice fashion, 1 over epsilon. Delta enters even better in a logarithmic fashion, and n enters in a linear fashion. So you say, well, this is the end of the story. Well, not really. Not really, and this gives us what I want to talk for a minute or two about sequential algorithms. First, I mean, let me define why we are interested in sequential algorithms. Well, the sample complexity is linear in the number of design parameters. However, suppose that you are interested in a Lyapunov problem. You're interested in positive definite symmetric matrix P. Well, the matrix P is dimension R by R, so the dimension of theta is really quadratic in R. So it's not really linear. So that's something that we have to keep into account. Another motivation is LMI. So suppose that you have now a semi-infinite optimization problem that you reduce using sampling subject to n bin LMIs. Now, you can stack all these n bin LMIs into one big block diagonal LMI and solve a semi-definite program. What is the complexity? Well, the complexity is n bin to the 1.5 power. So it's more than linear. So conclusion is that reducing n bin is necessary for medium to size problems. And here is, you know, the general picture that was proposed again by Alamo and others from Seville. And so the idea is that let's solve a reduced size scenario problem. Reduced size scenario problem, and so we take nk samples. And then we compute a temporary solution. This temporary solution is called theta hat, and then we perform a validation. If the validation is successful, then we stop. So we have yes, and if not, then we update. Okay, so how is this reduced size scenario problem? Well, we simply say that the number of constraints is now nk, which is n bin, it's a fraction of n bin. So it's n bin times k divided by the desired number of violations, the desired number of iterations, sorry. So we start with k equal to 1, which is the counter, and then we increase until we succeed. So we obtain this theta hat. And then we test using this validation oracle, which is a binary validation oracle, in the sense that we get either yes or no. Either we succeed or we fail. So we generate validation samples, v1, v2, vm, into q, and then we simply check if this solution satisfies all these validation samples. If yes, then we are done. If not, then we increase the validation counter. So the n of k was already defined as a fraction of n bin. The question is that what is m of k? Well, here there is a beautiful bound which was proposed a few years ago by Oishi in a different context, which is very simple. It's 1 over epsilon log of pi square k square divided by 6 delta. And this bound has been improved recently using the Riemann zeta function to get, you know, better bounds. But the point is that if you generate a number of validation samples which is dictated by this bound, then with probability at least minus delta, the violation of the scenario is small. So again, you know, this epsilon delta business, and here it tells us how many validation samples we have to do. Well, the question, what is, you know, here the point? The point is that the main idea to validate to a candidate solution is easier than computing a solution. So the sample complexity is computed a priori, n bin. Here, the sequential algorithm do not provide the sample complexity. So the number of iteration k is random. N of k and m of k are only established a priori. So this is the price that we have to pay. So we have a sequential algorithm which could be more effective, but the price that we have to pay is that these sequential algorithms do not provide the sample complexity. So here then there is a dichotomy between algorithms which are non-sequential, which provides the sample complexity, or algorithms which are sequential, could be more effective in numerical experiments, but then they have this drawback. So we did some experiment related to hard disk drive servo design, and this is a hard disk servo design that we actually used, and the point was to design a robust full-order H-infinity servo controller. Here we are looking for a storage density in the order of terabits per inch squared, and also, you know, very small deviation from the center track. So the problem becomes complicated because you have several weighting functions and so on. So at the end of the day, we have 9 uncertain nonlinear parameters and more than 150 design parameters. And then we perform 100 experiments in order to test the two algorithms. And the two algorithms are based, so these are numerical results, and we have different values of epsilon and delta and number of iterations. And here we computed the sample complexity of the scenario. Here is the computational time for the scenario approach, 500 seconds. Here is 1,500 seconds, and here it failed. We have too many constraints. So we couldn't compute a solution using the scenario. And so here with the sequential method, if you look at the computational time in the worst case, here it was worse than the scenario. Here it was worse, but here it succeeded. So what is the take-home message here? Perform both. Depending on what is the binomial complexity, the sample complexity for the binomial, if it is sufficiently small, then you can solve easily a semi-definite program. If it is not, then use sequential methods. Beyond convexity, I just want to spend a couple of minutes regarding the beyond convexity and statistical learning theory. Well, just to tell you a little more about uniform convergence. So let's recall that Monte Carlo simulation as the objective to approximate fixed violation function using the empirical violation. So the point is that we have a violation and then we have an empirical violation and we want to have the two close within epsilon with probability at least 1 minus delta. In the scenario approach, the violation function is computed at the theta scenario solution, which is given by the solution of this scenario approach. Statistical learning theory deals with a much more difficult and much harder problem, so it deals with uniform convergence for all theta. So now the violation function depends on design parameters, and the empirical violation also depends on these design parameters. The advantage is that there is no convexity assumption which is needed. Well, let's recall for a second that for fixed data, we have the OFD inequality. So we have a bound on this violation by this quantity. When we deal with statistical learning theory, we're interested in uniform convergence of empirical means. So we have uniform convergence for all theta. So you can see that here we had a crucial qualifier, which is supremum with respect to theta. The bound here, this bound, there are some different constants, but it's still an exponential factor. What is very different is that the presence of this bound, where this quantity here, which depends on D, this is a combinatorial parameter which is called the VC dimension. This is a fundamental result in the theory of empirical processes by Vapnik and Chervonenkis. As you probably know, Vapkin was recently hired by Facebook, so I'm sure that he can also make great contributions to Facebook. And sadly, Chervonenkis passed away a few months ago in Moscow. He was hiking in a forest not far from Moscow, and he got lost and he died overnight for hypothermia. What is the point of view from the why statistical learning is useful for control? Well, here, let me recall that we have some system constraints. And suppose that now the system constraints are polynomial in theta. So we don't have convexity here. We have polynomial in theta. In this case, the VC dimension is finite. A bound on D can be computed. The point I'm making here is that almost every control problem can be formulated in terms of polynomial constraints. Think about stability. You formulate the problem in terms of Hurwitz stability, Hurwitz stability. Then you get polynomial constraints. Actually, you get rational functions, but you can clear the denominator. So you can get you can easily get polynomial constraints. In this case, you can compute, it's tedious, but you can compute bounds on D, and so you can stick into D and then get bounds on the VC dimension. The drawback of this is that the sample complexity could be very large. And this line of research, in particular, was initiated by Vidyasagar, and then there is some subsequent work by Alamo and Camacho and myself. Some happenings at the frontier. I'm basically getting close to the end of my talk. Just very quickly, I'm going to list some four problems that I think are interested in. I'm actually interested in, and they hopefully this will generate future research. So the first one is the toolbox R-Romulok, which was released last week. This is a joint effort between the group in Toulouse. So there is a group in Toulouse. The key person in Toulouse working on this project is Dimitri Possel, and there was a very nice toolbox which was called Robust Multi-Objective Control Toolbox. And then in Torino we produced another toolbox which was called RACT, Randomized Algorithm Control Toolbox. Let's say let's join forces, and so we came out R-Romulok. It has been released last week, and you can download it for free, and you can try it out. We are going to work some more in the next few months, and we are going to add new features. So this is an exciting line of research, because at the end of the day, when you talk about randomized algorithms, you also want to have specific algorithms and specific tools available to the community. The second one is stochastic model predictive control that I mentioned at the beginning of my talk. I don't have time to go into details, but you remember the green region and the red region at the beginning of the talk. Now, the green region has been replaced by the blue region. The blue region is the feasibility region based on sampling approach. So the sampling approach allows us to construct this blue region. And one of the advantages is that the online complexity comparable to nominal MPC with terminal region, again, this is joint work by Matthias Lorenzen, Frank Algauer, Fabrizio Dabene, and myself. Another one, which is actually very interesting in my opinion, it's anti-wind-up design. This is joint work by Simone Formentin, Fabrizio Dabene, Luca Zaccarian, and Sergio Savaresi. And the point is that in here, we are interested in linear, saturated, uncertain systems. So there is a very key idea, which is somewhat new. And the idea is to decouple the design variables from the Lyapunov certificates for problems with parameter-dependent Lyapunov function. Randomization helps. And so to reduce conservatism, we've increased complexity. So conservatism can be reduced. However, the price that we pay, we increase complexity, but conservatism is reduced. And here are some pictures just showing that conservatism is actually can be reduced. The fourth line of research that I'm actually quite excited relates to techno-social networks. And so this is joint work by Paolo Frasca, Idea Kishi, Chiara Ravazzi, and myself, and this appeared in the special issue of European Journal of Control that was mentioned by Luigi during the opening ceremony. So the point of view here is that let's move on from randomizing a system to randomizing over networks. And this is for various problems like opinion dynamics in social networks, centrality measures, and page rank computation. There is a huge number of potential applications where these tools can be applied, moving on from, say, voting systems to viral marketing, smart cities, mobile vehicle to vehicle communications. I believe this is, you know, almost completely open research area. Well, conclusions. Take the optimistic viewpoint. I think that we are just at the beginning of a beautiful adventure, and I would like to thank lots of individuals who contributed directly or indirectly to this talk, and in particular, they contributed significantly to my own understanding of how randomization can tame uncertainty. Thanks for your attention. Enjoy the conference.
Many thanks that you have taught us how to tame uncertainty. So we have learned how to deal with this monster. So I think we should give him a second applause. For this really perfect talk. The discussion is postponed to the coffee break. You will find coffee outside or at the University Center. Thank you for taking part in this perfect plenary talk.